once before, I think maybe 12 years back, 13 years back, to contest in a tech fest, making an award from the ATM as family in the electrical engineer. So we had made an image processing robot and we had come here. I am as nervous as I was then, as I am today. I am not sure whether the robot would do as it is intended to do or not. But then I am also sure that I need not worry too much, because this is probably one of the more insulated institutes with brilliant minds, but pretty much very little social discourse and discussion. So I would be getting more tougher, much tougher questions elsewhere, where there is little more freedom to speak than go on with the single-minded agenda of a GPA or a CGPA and get into Google or Facebook. That's important. I'm not saying it's not important. But what is those millions worth if you don't save the country? So that's what brought me here, and I'm thankful to Professor Amit and the couple of other friends here, Akshay and other friends. I don't know your name, but someone. So, for welcoming here, I will try to keep it like a 30 minutes, 45 minutes session, and then more to do with interaction, and I'm sure a lot of questions will be there. So, how many of you think I'm courageous? How many of you think I'm privileged? How many? Yeah, just raise Yeah, it's more to do with my privilege than to do with my marriage. Because I'm a Hindu. Okay. So I can speak about Kashmir without being called a terrorist. A Muslim cannot speak about Kashmir without being called a terrorist in this country. Because the moment he says it's an Atankwadi mullah, I'm going to be very open, okay? If you, it's for the institute or something, I don't know. If I can't provoke your conscience, there's no point in my resignation process. So to come, yeah, so the next is I'm also an upper caste. Because I did not, of course, yet every upper caste person has this privilege of being caste blind. You don't have to worry about caste. And you feel your earthing is fine. It's the moment I resigned, everybody started asking that useless fellow got into by a quota, he should have got into by a some reservation quota into IAS, and screwing up the stance of one bright general student. And these are all things I faced. That's when I realized the privilege of being upper caste, because I had an answer. Let's assume if it was a person from a lower caste or a different world, they would come to that. So irrespective of the position you took, that would have been immediately discredited because the person is of X. Well, so that's the second privilege. The third is, of course, I am an IAS. So that's pretty much the epitome of privilege in this country. And so I can come out and speak and people would listen. Not because of what I'm saying, because who is saying. Because of those three, many of you are here because of those three letters. I'm sure someone would have been able to give a much better speech than I am on Kashmir. But you wouldn't have come to listen. Because of those three letters. And that's another privilege that's there. There are two privileges that I don't have. You know, sir. Now, of course, the fourth one. It's a privilege, so many. I'm a male. So, I talk to people that who... The kind of why that I abuse that I got once was that... somebody interviewed me, and an anchor, and a very famous anchor, and one of the abuse was like, I slept with his wife multiple times, and that's the reason he as a favor he interviewed me. I don't know what it was, but that is one of the things he said. So I went into his DM, director said, to the tutor, you have the DM, right? I went into it. I generally do that. Whoever gives me the worst kind of abuse, I pick two, three of them, and then I go to that DM. And then I say hi. Then I write that message, copy paste that message, whichever is, whatever it may be, but more than thing, whatever be it, I just put it there and say, do you really mean it or are you just angry at me? So 90% of the time they say, 99% of the times, people say, here I am able. So I was telling this to some of my female friends. Why don't you go into the DM? So they're like, man, you are a male, that's why you are saying you can go to a stateless DM. A female can never do that. I'm just saying the kind of privileges that, you know, one is not aware of. I'm just thinking of it when I'm coming here. There are two privileges I don't have. One is that I'm not from an IIT. If it was, you know, many of the IITs would have been like, oh, one of the IIT alumni association would have still been, you know, getting me around other places. And the fourth is I'm like, not very fair. So the kind of privileges in which, yeah, if you take six, I'm privileged in four, two, not much. But that's a privilege which I'm speaking, and that's a privilege many of you are sitting there are having. Whether you have it or not doesn't matter, but you have to speak up. Because if you don't speak up for your fellow citizens, then whom do you speak for? What is national integration? If I am not concerned about what is happening in Kashmir, can you ever say he is a fellow citizen? If somebody is bringing you here, on your forefinger somewhere, take blood. Does it hurt here? Does it hurt here? It hurts, right? You don't say that, oh, it's very far away, somewhere here, so it doesn't matter to me. No, this is the nation. It should train all of us. It should. But it did not. I did not resign in protest against the government. I resigned in protest against this country. Because we did not, as a nation we failed. It's not as a government. Governments are always power maximizers. All the governments, irrespective of X, Y, Z, it doesn't matter. But when it comes to, but the government is not the only institution in this country. We have our media, we have our judiciary, we have civil society, we have so many of us, you, me, academia, all those things. So many of us. And we all just decided to keep quiet. Simply we decided to keep quiet. And we said it is all in national interest. Everything is in national interest. You might be still, right now we are just talking about communication blockade. It took 69 days to start talking about communication blockade. Because in the initial time when I resigned, we were saying that people are celebrating there. That's a video that everybody showed in the media. And that's what we all believe. We wanted to believe. That's what we went ahead with. That's another thing we wanted to go ahead with. The Press Council of India chairman gives a affidavit saying that we are okay with the restrictions placed by the government. We are okay. The media is saying we are okay with the restrictions placed by the government on the media. So that's a dangerous thing, because before I worked in Mizoram, and there are 20 years of anti-insurgency operations there. I was collector there, BC, Aizawl, and then before that in Nathia. So, 20 years of anti-insurgency, and the rest of the country did not know what happened there because the media did not cover. It is 65-85, so we can say that it was then. But what is now? This is 21st century, 2019, and this is democratic India. And here, our media is saying that we agree with what our restrictions government has put, we go by what the government is saying. What is supposed to be the media's job? To find out the truth and report. It's a very simple thing. If there are two versions, publish both versions. If you think one version is not correct, publish both. That's all. Very simple. You don't go by the national interest. One of the officers was arrested, Mr. Shah Faisal. He still has a resignation aspirant. I'm not a resign. I'm a resignation aspirant, just like civil service aspirant. So, because I have written my paper, they have not yet accepted. So I'm aspiring for resignation. So a fellow resignation aspirant, his paper is also not accepted. It's been 8-9 months. I don't know much about Shah Faisal. But when he was arrested in Delhi and then taken out from Delhi to Srinagar and said that there was a PSA slab, etc. I remember writing in our groups, IAS groups, that why is it that a person is arrested for traveling elsewhere? Is there any report notice? Is there any case against him? Okay, just assume one of you are going elsewhere and you are arrested. But there should be some reason to be arrested. This is a democratic country, this is a constitutional democracy. It's not a, you know, anybody can do anything. It's not like that. So nobody has responded. I felt very bad. If in one of our own services, he just resigned, he would have resigned 6 months back. But we are just keeping quiet. In the WhatsApp groups, we are keeping quiet. In the Facebook posts, we are keeping quiet. In the newspapers, we are keeping quiet. Everywhere, we are just, you know, we are so worried, we are so bothered, we are so afraid to speak up our mind. So then, that happened. Then his wife went and filed a habeas corpus, if I'm not wrong. Habeas corpus, everybody knows. It's just like bring the, you know, person. Huh? And it's the most fundamental of your rights. And most fundamental, right to life and liberty is how we, you know, establish that fundamental right. That's the most fundamental of that. And the government says that we do not have the statement ready. The person has already been detained. And he has been taken to Srinagar. See, the funny thing about PSA or Public Safety Act or any such act is that it is to prohibit somebody from coming to a troubled area, a disturbed area. Okay, that you don't want somebody to come to a disturbed area. This fellow was in Delhi. He was taken from Delhi and taken to Srinagar, which is the troubled area. And I'm saying that you would slap PSA on. So then the government is saying that we don't have a statement ready. We do not have the statement ready. For a person was detained and to the Delhi High Court on a habeas corpus petition, the government is saying we do not have the statement ready. So what should the court do? What should the judiciary do? Simply speaking, it should blast the government. Saying that you are arrested, you don't even have the reasons, you don't even come up with the reasons for why you have been detained. The government says we give you, judiciary says we give you 15 days. The government asks for 15 days and the judiciary says, okay, we give you 15 days to find out reasons on why you were arrested. Imagine. And then that habeas corpus was sort of put pressure, I don't know what, how it was withdrawn. Almost all the habeas corpus petitions were withdrawn. The number of people who are put in a hotel, detained in a hotel, without any due process. These are all information I am receiving. There is no nothing. If they get out, then their PSA would be stamped. They are told, if you get out of the hotel, then their PSA would be stamped. If you just stay inside the hotel because you have a TV, you have everything, you just stay there, your family can come and visit. Where do you want to create unnecessary trouble? Because if a PSA is stamped, then you might have to be taken to the jail. So, staying there. Right now, today, it's happening. In our country. In our country, this is happening. We can continue with our aerospace and whatever engineering we're doing. No, I'm serious. I would have continued with my bungalow and my PSO and whatever was there though. But when you are in a position of privilege, it's not a great power that comes with responsibility. It's a great privilege that comes that way. And you're all, each one of you sitting here is privileged. The mere fact that you're here is privileged, irrespective of anything else. And if you're not able to speak up when something is wrong, I went to one of the premium institutes, economic institutes, like this. Many people from here, after their degree, meter, would, you know, in fact, including me also, would study and then get into another premium institute, another three-letter institute. So I went to one of those three-letter institutes. I'm not denigrating or anything. They are all pillars of excellence. But then we have a habit of, you know, being like a, you know, racehorse. You just look like this and just go straight like that. You know, don't look here, don't look there. What is it that you want? You go there. So expectedly, the thing is that somebody else is joking. You are not. You are just being that. So I asked a very simple question. You have a center for policy studies and something here? Public policy and all here? Yeah? Okay. So that was the question I asked there. That how many of you think, a simple question, how many of you think demonetization is one of the key reasons why we are the economic system here? How many of you? Here. Or anybody who does not think? You don't think?
I think it's in the complex process. One of the reasons.
One of the reasons is, one of the key reasons, we can disagree. How many of you think it was in the national interest? None. So if it was not in the national interest, okay, let me ask the next question. How many of you have publicly expressed your views against demonetization? How many of you have not? Why? No, publicly expressed in the sense, articles, if you're in a position, so obviously, I'm not saying just talking to somebody, okay? That is not publicly expressing your views. At least a minimum Twitter post or a Facebook post where your friends can see, not a WhatsApp group. How many of you have done that? Yeah, good, at least this is better than the other institute that I have. Why I'm saying this, three questions. One is that you think something is not in national interest, all of it, but you decide to not speak up against it. Right? Many of, almost everybody in the room felt that it was not in the nation's interest. Okay? But maybe 60% decided not to speak up against it. Why? See, the patriot should speak up, right? It should be, you know, who's an anti-national? Who's an anti-national? An anti-national, I would define, many of you are sitting here up because you knew something was not in the nation's interest. And you decided to put your own greed or fear or your promotion or mental peace or whatever be it, or your relationships, friendships, all of that above your national interest, and that's why you decided to keep quiet. And that's why, or you did not care enough. Either way, you have put everything else above the nation. So who is the real anti-national? The person who is speaking up is never the real anti-national. Because he thinks something is bad for the country. The person who is supporting it is also not the anti-national, because he thinks that is good for the country. The person who thinks it is bad and still decides to keep quiet for his own gains, thinking that, you know, the political scenario would change and then I might be able to join the other bandwagon. You are the real anti-nationals. Because you decide to keep quiet, keep everything else, you know. So this is something I want to say because I went there, and there it was, at least here I could find 5-10. Then it would find hardly 3. And those are the people who are supposed to decide policies and at least influence policies. How many papers have we published on demonetization and the impact of economy? Let's assume this was happening in US and such a massive step would have happened. How many messages, how many publications would have come on the impact on the informal economy and the impact on taking out CAC and the people who asked me a very simple question. Wasn't this a historic decision? The 370, removal of 370. I asked, wasn't demonetization a historic decision? Here, the thing is that we have sort of started making decisions historic before even taking the decision. Today we are going to take Aaj Kuch Tufani Kar. That's okay. Aaj Hum Kuch. Historic, aitihasik, nirnay lena hai aaj. So, I can mix Hindi, English, or if there is any concern, let me know. So, you took the decision. There are quite a few parameters on which you took the decision. Okay. I would say this decision is historic or not, whether it has achieved those targets or not. So, when you are taking the decision, you have to set out the targets. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These are the targets that I want to. And this is the time frame in which I will achieve. And whether it has achieved or not. Let's take demonetization. I ask this question because these are things you should be studying. These are things you should be studying and putting reports on. One was that black money. Of course, we know 100% money came back. Right? Second was, I'm pretty sure more than 100% came back. Because this happened in the 70s. This was not the first time. But then we did not document. It happened in the 76, if I am not wrong, 76 or 74, which is the year, I don't know. Then, RBI got more money than it was actually given. And then they did not publish the white paper on it. Because they are worried that how do you get more money. The less we the percentage, you know, as a percentage of GDP as well as how did it happen? It was going down, it went dip, and then it went up again. Now that if you look at the graph, it is more than what was actually before the demonetization. And of course, that point of time, there was very less cash in the system, you took all the cash away. So, it's supposed to be less cash in the system. So, cash is circulation. The next was counterfeit currency. There is another issue. You know what happened 3 days back? 3-4 days back? RBI decided not to print 2000 rupees, not anymore. You know what is the reason? Yeah, because they said high quality counterfeit currency has come. So, RBI is saying they are anyway printing high quality stuff. You know, so, why duplicate the effort? Why should you also print? Let them print these stocks. So, now only counterfeit people are printing. We are not printing. So, counterfeit also gone. Then, terrorism. Second time we are distributing sweets in this country for the end of terrorism. One was demonetization. I remember because we did that. Then of course, after surgical strike, we did that again, end of terrorism. And then Balakot strike also, we did again, end of terrorism. And then we did Kashmir also for saying end of terrorism. Okay? And we are distributing sweets across the country, saying the same things. So, 370, I would like the government to tell what are its goals. A constitutional amendment, I might have difference with Danish here. We might differ on so many things. But if it's a constitutional amendment which is here, which is to be cut down by the government, there are two checks. One is a decision, that's a government decision. Whether it is constitutional or not, will have been decided by the Supreme Court. Okay? I don't agree with the process. Okay? The issue for me is not the decision per se. I'll be very upfront about it. But it is about the process of doing it. How it was done, and after it was done, how it was taken forward, both the things. But I also want the government to say, when they are saying we are going to develop Kashmir, what is it that they want to do? The GDP is today X, are they going to bring Y by so many years? My human development index is this, what is it that they want to take the Kashmir by so many years? My number of terrorist incidents is this much, what is it that it is going to become? My civilian deaths, casualties are this much today, how is it going to be in 5 years? My military casualty is this much, how is it going to be this much? You come up with parameters and say after 5 years you can decide. Whatever you did, you know, because I'm afraid 3 months we suffered, this entire country suffered, stood up in queues, people died, people are not even knowing their own money, entire country were made to stand up like that, and that was an experiment. We were all part of guinea pigs, we just did, we were asked to do that, we were told that you can't take your own money. We said yes, it is for national interest. You are told that it is for national interest. So, always there will be such kind of things. Once it will be for black money. So, nobody can speak up against black money, right? Why I am saying so? Is at the time of demonetization, everybody was saying it is a great decision, disclosure decision, blah blah, let's see decision. All sort of things are coming on my Facebook. I was DCI at that point of time. I was thinking 2 days later. I was thinking it's going to be a mess, very clear. It's not going to be the way it is going to be. And the thing was that they did after the Diwali, but before the Christmas. See, in the Northeast, Christmas is the time of celebration. So, the Christmas, they normally had money. So, their Christmas was completely. That's how when a majority decision making happens, you don't realize how. So, Diwali is important, so waited till Diwali. After Diwali, you take a decision without worrying that Christmas is coming. So, Christmas was completely ignored. Then, I wrote on my Facebook and Twitter saying that a great decision need not be a good decision. Nobody would understand. So, you know, nobody would understand what it means. So people would have to call me up and say, what is that? I said, you want this? No, yes, makes sense. But at that point of time, I realized, by making those slight tweets, you know, slight posts, already I am feeling like Bhagat Singh. That I have rebelled against the government. I have rebelled against this, you know, for the country, for the sake of this nation, I have rebelled. Just by posting one stupid post. So many of us have already started feeling so. Because that's why many of us don't post anything. Because the moment you post, as he said, anti-national or, you know, urban Naxal, whatever it calls, all those things would start coming into it. start. So we don't do any of that anymore. We don't do a Facebook post, we don't do a Twitter. But if you remember, I remember getting out on the streets also. I was with Motorola, this year's semiconductors. We are a citizen engineer. And we felt, we played for 25 years of this Bhopal tragedy. I remember going and sitting in a chair. Of course, for a day, when you think I was very hungry. So I had to come back. But we did it. And I never felt like I was an anti-national Naxal or anything. I felt patriotic doing that. Because criticizing government was used to be the most favorite pastime. Criticizing government was like, you know, dipping biscuit in tea. So this trial though, this is what I'm even more afraid about. Because if people are made to feel like a Bhagat Singh just by posting on a Facebook or a Twitter, what is happening is self-censorship. Nobody has put you in jail, nobody is asking you not to do it. But you're all deciding to keep, you know, your levels of disagreement to a minimum possible level. And with a minimum visibility, nobody should know. I can speak to him, provided he will not speak to somebody else about my disagreement. It be it anybody, be it as an institution you would be seeing it. As an IIT, you might have disagreement with that institution. You don't want to speak that, speak up about it. Because when you are doing that, thing you fear. There are three things for which you don't speak up. One is greed. Greed is, you know, the chance of getting something if I keep quiet. The other is fear. The fear of losing something if I speak up. The fourth is I don't care. It simply doesn't matter to me. So there are three reasons on which you are doing this. Any of this, second and later, the self-censorship is what I'm more worried about. I saw an article, letter to editor on a week. If you could get a copy of the week last weekend. The letter says, letter to the editor is published, it says, see, why did you decide to cancel Swara Bhaskar's column? Swara Bhaskar was writing a column in the week. If I have not read her column, then it's just the letter to editor. She never criticized Prime Minister Modi. She never criticized the government. Then why did you remove her column? And this is published, you can check. Imagine. What is it that we are saying? That if you criticize, then it's okay. She is just giving a different viewpoint without taking names or criticizing government. So, that much of space should be there in democracy. Self-censorship. Where we have to shout and scream, we have to shout and scream. When Kashmir happened, we should have shouted and screamed. Instead, we kept quiet. I don't know how is it possible. If you are watching TV, if you are looking at it, how is it possible for you to, you know, understand and listen to what is happening there and just keep quiet like that? How is it possible? When civilian leaders are jailed, imagine tomorrow Maharashtra decides that the petrol price will be increased by 100 rupees. Okay? There will be protests, like this example I take everywhere. There will be protests, right? There will be, you know, some of the trains, state transport bus would be burnt, somebody would throw stones, all those things would happen. This would happen, of course, in Kashmir it happens with an external agency. Different geopolitical issues are there. But here also, some protest would happen. It is immediately increased from 70 to 170. It will happen. Agree or not?
Yes.
It happened, it will happen vociferously. If it is increased to 170, I don't think I don't have any. Most of them would just continue like this, we'll keep saying that what happened. But let's assume people are still a little more aware and do protest. What if the Maharashtra government says that I am going to arrest and detain all the opposition leaders? Here. All the leaders. And I am going to put a curfew in the entire state. Because there could be protests, there could be storm building, there could be a road blockade, there could be so many things. Then I am going to shut down the entire communication in the state. And then, no landline, no mobile, no internet. Nothing. Then you cannot get out curfew. Imagine that. Imagine that for 20 days, 25 days, 30 days. is it acceptable? No, is it or not?
No.
If it is not acceptable in Maharashtra, why is it acceptable in the state? Or we consider them not to be part of India. If that is the case, then we have. Now I am asking a very simple question. Are they part of India or not? Yes, then why do you have different set of values? But when a different set of standards is put, the rest of the country should keep quiet. So, you took the decision. People are saying, many of the arguments are like, it's a bitter pill. You know, it's an injection. It's the kid has to be given, administered. In short of a child, so, after injection, they're not going to die. So then you say that, you know, they were not consulted. Kashmiris were not consulted before taking this decision. So they say, the kid will never agree to an injection. They say it is for their own good, we are the parents. So, that was given. Which parent does not allow the kid to cry after the injection? You're all, some of you might be having, you know, kids, some of you might have your siblings. You've seen taking your kid to inject hospital. You know the injection is administered. After that, how many of you have kept, told the child that you keep quiet? Shut up. That's what we did. We infantilized them without consenting. Then you are not even allowing them the right to react to a government decision. The government has a right to take a decision. I'm not denying that. Government has every right to take a decision. Whether it is wrong, right, constitutional or not, etc., will not be decided by the Supreme Court and other places. But the government has no right to take the people's right to react. Both coexist. The Maharashtra government can say, I am increasing my petrol prices by 100 rupees. That coexists with the people's right to respond to it saying that we don't accept. And if the government is saying, to protect your own life, to protect your life, you know, the saving your life, I have to take your liberty. That's the argument. Why the communication is not restored, why the mobile phones are not restored, why the internet is not restored, why landlines, you know, all these things. The argument is that it is to protect the lives of the people. Imagine where our government's expectations have come. The government is now saying to its people, we cannot ensure your life and liberty together. Either you pick liberty or you pick life. Forget about development or becoming Singapore. They were saying that we become Singapore another sometime. Forget about all that. Now we have come to a stage where the government is saying, you either pick life, because we cannot ensure both. If you give you communication, we cannot ensure your life. Some of you are, you know, might misuse that communication freedom and take life. And if I give you life, then I have to not ensure people. That's the most incompetent government I have seen, which cannot even ensure the fundamental rights, the basic fundamental rights of right to life and liberty. Forget about anything else, don't give us anything. The right to life and liberty is a fundamental right that no government can take, even during emergency. Even during emergency, it cannot be taken. But the government is saying no. You have to choose one. It is to save your own life. If I have to put all of you in jail to save your own life, you will be happy. I say that is exactly what is happening. So, this and the way it is done, executive decisions. Constitutional rights are being, you know, taken away by executive decisions. By simple saying orders, this 107, 107, this is for local one day, two day thing. People have been kept under that for months. And we seem to be okay. So, it happened, people asked like whether it was a trigger. Resign from the service. It's not a trigger. It's like the frog in the boiling water. How many of you know? If you put a frog in the slowly boiling water, it never jumps out. No. It will stay there. If you have to slow, heat it slowly. It will burn. It will boil there. It will still not jump out. So I was feeling the heat. I thought if I don't get out, it's difficult. And this is not just Kashmir, okay? Kashmir is the explicit manifestation of what is happening. In a lot of places. The That's an explicit manifestation that we can do. I was so much worried, and so upset and disappointed. This dog was, you know, you remember that there was a sheep which it's got, I think Amit Shah was going into the parliament and one sheep was there.
Yeah.
Right? There was one. There are 20 things which was written. It was even written that, but if there is a rebellion against the uniform forces, there was 20 points. When will the Prime Minister brief the other country, UNP, etc. There are 20 points mentioned in that. It just got leaked while he was getting out of the page or something. You know, that entire page, there was not a single point which said how to manage protests in the rest of the country. In the planning, in the government's planning, they were very clear. Whatever you do in Kashmir, the rest of the country is not going to respond. So there was no plan. And we were very much, they were very correct. The assessment was absolutely correct. None of us responded. We just kept. I was so upset with that. I would have liked that one line, because when I am making for a 144 or something line, I make all those contingencies. Things which I don't absolutely, you know, I'm absolutely clear will never happen to me, leave from that. And that was not there. I was giving this talk to one of these things initially, first in fact, in Chennai, not the IIT Chennai. So one of the girl gets up and says, what kind of freedom, what kind of dissent, etc. I am a 23-year-old girl. I am not even sure tomorrow whether I am Indian or not. Indian. I am 23-year-old Indian, but I am not sure whether I am Indian or not. Anymore. She is from Assam or tomorrow. So she said that, and she is saying, you know, if I am Indian, then only this thing has come. How many of you are detention centers people? Yes. Are we waiting for gas chambers? In Assam, this happened that the girl was asking this question. I came here, I came to Mumbai. Then, a couple of people were working here, see, recent morning very well, Muslims. And I was talking to them and I said, see, this happened in Assam, this girl was standing up and saying, considered as non-citizens. And you say, maybe fine immigrants. Immigrants who is not able to produce document. And then you read that sentence again. How does it affect now? And this is happening again in our country. This is, I just went through most, this is by Arts Legal Men. You should read it's about the, this is very good. You may come to AUS. This is happening. What happens is bureaucracy, being in bureaucracy, you start looking at very, very small things. Very small things. And you are smart city. I have seen people do smart city projects. So when you are doing the smart city projects, your efficiency is like, people would come and say, sir, we have these good cameras, surveillance cameras, put it here, put it there, put it there, put it here. We will be able to know from your control room, you know, who has crossed the line. So I was asking, why do I want to know whether a person has crossed the line in the city? Why should I know it? They said, no, if a person is falling down, then you will be able to know. So what do I do? So you can send from the control room the ambulance to that person. So I said, I would rather have two people who are standing there nearby him, call an ambulance and send it. Because the argument is what? The technology. How is the technology is purely for more and more information. The governance, the smart city is becoming what? Where the citizen is becoming more transparent to the government. Citizen is becoming more transparent, citizen is becoming more accountable to the government. Because you are being asked to do a lot of things, right? It's not the government. You are constantly under pressure that am I doing enough for my country? You are constantly under this pressure that whether I am doing enough for the country, be it any of those things. I was writing it initially, it started with giving up. For that young machine, you started with giving up. We are all giving up. Then they said, give up your cash, you won't take this. You won't give up your cash. They say it on PNC also. You say, okay. So, you know, it just, you know, five, six like that. You say, give up your peace, you give up I, you give up this thing, you just started, people started voluntarily giving up things. And every time they give it up, it becomes history. And that is something you have to worry about. It's not at all about one government. The thing is that any government which comes, pretty much go by this narrative. Because the machinery is set. The machinery is set. The bureaucracy works by the president. Whatever happened earlier can happen now. And that becomes dissent is, you know, I just say a very simple thing about how many, you know, we have make these pandals, right? Pandal Shadi ke liye. Pandal banate hain. Usme wo khamba jo bamboo ka guard thing. We erect a pole, right? What is that you do immediately after that? After you erect the pole, what do you do? You will check. How will you check? Shaking. You know, that's the first thing. You put that, then you will, you know, just shake it up and see. And that is the importance of dissent in a democracy. It is not to make the whole thing fall down. It is to check whether it is strong enough. Any decision, be any authority, why is it important to question authority? It is because it is important to know whether the decision is strong enough. If somebody is saying, you know, somebody is dissenting like this, and some, you know, you would immediately try to go to his home and try to burn his house, saying that you know, bhai, mandap nahi, pandal nahi gira raha. शादी के टाइम में गिर जाए बस ये देख लेते हैं कुछ कर लिया हम इसी बात से डरते हैं कि कोई आके दो सवाल पूछ लिया तो क्या हमारी वो इनसिक्योरिटी है तो तुरंत यू वांट टू अटैक अ पर्सन अभी तो तुरंत वही जाएंगे मैं एक और थोड़ा एग्जांपल बताना चाहता हूँ एवरीबॉडी वांट्स राम राजे इट्स ओके बट So when Ram went to Lord Ram went to Sriganka, killed Ravan, came back with Sita, and then came to Ayodhya. This time, somebody got up and asked a question to Ram. question? What was the question?
Good wife.
Yes. Was that a democracy? That was a monarchy. And he was not a citizen, he was a praja. The question was disgusting. It's a completely, you know, let's assume it was some other question. Okay, I know that's not a, this was a point like the one. But let's assume it was some other question. But that citizen, or not a citizen, the praja, a subject, could get up and ask about to the raja about his wife. And was he lynched?
No.
See, we, our own history, our own myths are not like that. We have always embraced questioning. We have always embraced dissenting. We have always embraced freedom of expression. We have to pick up the right examples and the right things. There are wrong two things in the same example. One is the wrong thing, one is the right thing. What do you want to pick up from that? Today we are not subjects, we are citizens. Citizen is like, democracy is when it's from the people, right? Monarchy is the divine right of the king to rule. So they are not getting the right from the people. It is their right to rule. And the subject is just like, you know, whatever is they say.
What citizen?
Absolutely no right. Subjects don't have rights. So in a monarchy, in a kingdom, you have subjects, or praja and raja. In a democracy, you have nagrik. Raja or nagrik in okay. So we are a citizen.
Even subject could ask
you. That's what my question. When a subject could ask you, we don't have any right. So praja ka bilkul koi adhikar nahi tha. Wo bhi pooch sakta. Par hum pooch nahi sakte. Ya hum poochna nahi chahte. But this is something we want to. And only thing is that if at all, the talk actually helps you to understand what is happening. The larger context is one thing, but something which is very immediate, very explicit, something is happening in our country. This is not happening in some, Sudan or Yemen or something that we can just continue to ignore. This is happening in our country. This is happening in 2019. You know, and US Senate is having a 4-hour discussion on that, whereas we unfortunately have not been able to. One question that most of the reporters who are going to Kashmir are wasted. How is the rest of the country responding to what is happening to us? How is the rest of the country responding to what is happening to us? Very simple question. What is your answer?
Nothing.